I'll share this reading that comes from the Gospel of Matthew. Let's go to that mountaintop and hear what Jesus is saying to us this day. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The word of God for the people of God. God is still speaking. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Most gracious and loving God, may the meditations of our hearts, the words of my mouth, be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A church member had been hospitalized in ICU. When you go to visit people in ICU, you have to walk by that reception desk. The folks who work that desk have a precarious responsibility, because they receive people who are anxious, scared, worried, terrified, impatient, hungry, tired. People who are there because of the reminder that we all receive from time to time that when it comes to this thing called life, we are ultimately not in control. This is the sensitive dynamic that the person at the ICU reception desk deals with day in and day out. In short, their position can be an unfortunate one. So I was surprised when I walked up to the ICU reception desk that day and I made the passing comment to the person standing behind it, "How are you doing?" And she responded without flinching, "Oh, I'm blessed." She said it in an almost defensive way that implied, "You should know this. I'm blessed. Why are you even asking?" Today, that exchange at the reception desk has me wondering, so what does it mean to be blessed? When Jesus goes up to the top of a mountain, he's following in the footsteps of Moses, who scaled Mount Sinai to receive and to later deliver the very word of God. Jesus, the embodiment and essence of God, the one who came up out of the waters of baptism to be called beloved by the voice of God, Jesus is now delivering the word of God to the people. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus begins this sermon with a series of blessings called the Beatitudes, or as the youth group calls them, the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, and so forth. These are the Beatitudes. So what does it mean to be blessed? The word beatitude is Latinized from the original Greek, drawn from a Greek word makarios. Makarios means supremely blessed, in a privileged circumstance, well off, fortunate, happy. So the woman at the ICU reception desk who greets us in our anxiousness, who receives the raw nature of our humanity, who sees many of us at our worst, who has been called more than once by an impatient man, "Lady," contrary to popular belief, she is not underprivileged, not well off, unfortunate, unhappy. No, she is supremely blessed in a privileged circumstance. Well off, fortunate, happy. "How are you doing today?" "Oh, I'm blessed." "And don't you forget it." On that mountaintop, Jesus talks with the people. He speaks to the ones who have been trampled upon by the powers that be, the ones who have been chewed up and spit out by the Roman Empire so much that they have convinced themselves that they're nothing, that they're nobody and they're going nowhere. God's beloved Jesus sits with the lowly working class, the ones shunned by the government, forgotten by the religious elites, people who have been led to believe that they will only go so far in life and that to fight against that reality is a foolish waste of time. And Jesus says to them, "You are blessed." Well, there goes Jesus, flipping things over again, teaching us would-be followers of his that making sure we have a flush 401k and a house with a mortgage and a nice neighborhood and a car too fancy for Pope Francis to ride in will not make us blessed. But that the ones who are so poor that they are poor in spirit, that they are blessed now. There goes Jesus telling us that the Beatitudes are not a prescription for living a blessed life, but a description of the lives of those who are blessed in their context where they are right now. See, we read, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," and the temptation is to think, I can do that. I can live a life of spiritual poverty. I just need to buy some Thomas Merton books on Amazon and maybe take on a prayer discipline, you know, maybe beat my breast a little just for good measure. But Jesus is talking to people who are poor. He's assuring them right then and there that in spite of their seemingly hopeless situation, they are blessed by God. Warren Carter, professor of New Testament at Bright Divinity School, points out that the poor in spirit are the ones who know poverty as their daily existence, the ones who don't know what it's like to have three meals a day or to be able to visit a doctor or a dentist or to have a grocery store within a mile of the home that they don't have. These are the ones who live with poverty so much that it gets into their bones like cancer, and it demoralizes their self-image until they become literally poor in spirit. Now, Jesus isn't calling us to be that. Jesus is calling our attention to that. So if this is what it means to be blessed, then what are the implications of this blessing on those of us who do not know, nor experience, nor understand such poverty? Let's take a look at that third beatitude. Blessed are the meek, for they will, what? Inherit the earth. The temptation is to say, well, I can swallow my pride. I can be meek. I can be a doormat. Maybe I just need to be like those monks that I see on the History Channel, just be really gentle and nice all the time, as if those monks are. Then the earth will be mine. But when Jesus says, "Blessed are the meek," he's actually quoting Psalm 37, which we find in the Hebrew Scriptures, what we often refer to as the Old Testament. Psalm 37 talks about wicked men exploiting people by taking their land away from them, by running pipelines through their backyards and sacred burial grounds against their wishes, by labeling their neighborhood an inner city hood so they can more easily gentrify it. And in Psalm 37, the meek are defined as the poor, as those who are oppressed by the wealthy, those who are victimized by the powerful, those whose land is taken away from them. Just a few verses from Psalm 37, and read it in its entirety if you get a chance today. "Yet a little while, and the wicked will be no more. Though you look diligently for their place, they will not be there. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant prosperity. The wicked borrow and do not pay back, but the righteous are generous and keep giving. For those blessed by the Lord shall inherit the land, but those cursed by him shall be cut off." Basically, Psalm 37 explains how the people who are demoralized by the powers of their day to the point of giving up when this injustice happens to them, they are blessed. because their land will ultimately be restored to them. And Jesus reminds us, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Now, this doesn't appear to be happening right now, the meek inheriting the earth. But it's outlined for us right here in our sacred story. It's part of the plan. And Jesus is drawing our attention to it. He says to the meek and to the poor in spirit, God loves the whole world, yes, but God holds you in utmost favor. The lesson for everyone is that when people are being called underprivileged, unfortunate, not well off, wickedness is up to something. Because when people are labeled at risk, alien, criminal, it's easy for us to shrug our shoulders when their land is taken away, or when their drinking water won't be fixed in Flint to the tune of $55 million while a wall proceeds to be built for billions. The lesson is that the ones assumed to be lost causes are held in utmost favor by God. The lesson is that they are blessed, and the voice of God's justice, righteousness, and steadfast love is speaking most potently through the blessed. The lesson is that you don't mess with the blessed. You listen to the blessed. You listen to God's blessings and the implications of those blessings. We had a chance to do that this week. This week we heard Thomas Gabor speak at Rudder Theater. How many of y'all were there? It's a good gathering. It's a good gathering. Thomas Gabor is from the Fighting Texas Aggie class of 61. And he is a Jew who survived the Holocaust. Wednesday night, Gabor shared his story with us. Rudder Theater was filled to capacity. Hundreds were turned away when the standing room only crowd exceeded that fire code. But even still, a few hundred more sat on the ground listening to Gabor's speech piped outside the theater. To listen is a blessing. Gabor was a boy living in Budapest when the Nazis came for his family. Men with machine guns ordered people to come out of their homes. And when the Jews were corralled outside, the man who was apparently in charge of this debacle said, "Men over there, women over there, old people and children over there." But when they began tearing families apart, Gabor couldn't let go of his mother. He told us, when you grow up with so much anti-Semitism, with people telling you that who you are is wrong, you develop an inferiority complex. Now, I've seen movies about the Holocaust and dramatic reenactments in documentaries about the Holocaust where the Nazis separate the Jews by gender and age, tearing families apart. And in those movies, it makes perfect sense to me when I see children clinging to their parents because, of course, they're terrified. But before Wednesday night, I'd never heard about the inferiority that Jewish children felt when being torn from their parents. Sure, Gabor was scared to death of being separated from his mother, but according to his testimony, the reason why he was so scared was because anti-Semitism had led him to believe that he was so inferior that if he were to be separated from his parents, he would suddenly become nothing. He wouldn't exist. It's into human experiences such as these that Jesus says, you are not nothing. You are held in utmost favor by God. You are blessed. To the young person of color who is fed the glaring statistic that 1 in 3 black males will go to prison in their lifetime, Jesus speaks to them where they are and says, don't swallow that counterfeit gospel. You are privileged because God holds you in utmost favor. To the LGBTQ person who is told from the pulpit in his church and in his Sunday school class and even by his own family that because of his sexual orientation and gender identity, he is going to hell. Jesus invites him to a mountaintop and says, don't internalize that counterfeit gospel. You are well off because God holds you in utmost favor. To the person with disabilities who sees the man who holds the highest office in this country publicly mock a journalist with disabilities and then witnesses the crowd around him laugh and absorb the normalization of such cruel behavior, Jesus invites her to a mountaintop and says, "Don't believe that counterfeit gospel. You are fortunate because God holds you in utmost favor. You are supremely blessed." Now, given the reality of those who are marginalized, oppressed, exploited, victimized in our present day, we might hear these Beatitudes declaring that they are actually in privileged circumstances, fortunate, well off, and supremely blessed, and we might skeptically think, there goes Jesus again with his alternative facts. But there's that wicked framework that only advances the demoralization of God's people. To say that there are facts and there are alternative facts that you can choose from which ones you prefer that best suits you, that's counterfeit gospel. The lesson is that there are facts and there is truth. The fact is that as of this weekend, resettlement programs have been halted under the guise of defending our country against terrorism, which will leave refugees who are fleeing unspeakable violence with that much less hope. And the truth is that we are to treat the sojourner with utmost hospitality in order to make room for the blessings of God to be revealed. You don't mess with the blessed. The fact is that Syrian refugees who are among the most vulnerable human beings in the world right now are all of a sudden banned from entering our borders. But the truth is that when we welcome the stranger, Jesus teaches us, we welcome Christ himself. You don't mess with the blessed. The fact is that this new reality that was signed into effect over the weekend, since then, hatred of Muslims has been validated with an Islamic center in Victoria, Texas, being set on fire Saturday morning. And the truth is that whatever is done to the least of these, the ones Jesus calls blessed, is done to him. You don't mess with the blessed. Perhaps what Jesus is teaching us in these harrowing times is that until we recognize all of God's children as blessed, until the first are made last and the last made first, none of us will really know what it means to be blessed. Blessed are the peacemakers, Jesus says, for they will be called children of God. There's wickedness afoot, good people, and it's waging war on the ones Jesus calls blessed. It's giving the most vulnerable among us inferiority complexes that have no part in God's plan. So here is the good news. Blessed are those who recognize the facts and meet them with the truth. For they will be a reflection of the kingdom of God. So, stand up, make peace, do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. Let the world know that you don't mess with the blessed. And by this, we will all be called children of God. Amen.